So it's very heartening to hear that an organization which is led by you, that you hire coaches. And, you know, so one of the things that business owners, you know, I'm seeing them in three different buckets. Bucket number one are people who are clear that working with a coach can help them accelerate their growth. Bucket number two, don't want to go to a coach, but now they are stuck. And the only way out is to get a coach to move forward. And bucket number three is, look, we can't be bothered with coaches. We want to do stuff on our own. And, you know, so what is the way in which one can communicate that, listen, there are these processes that are available. People have been there, done that. And once you work with a coach, you can really move things forward. So, you know, how do you get that?
Well, you know, in the getting things done model that, you know, I've engineered really is just really identifying the multiple levels that we have commitments. And I've identified essentially the six horizons that we have commitments about. There's purpose, there's the vision of that purpose being fulfilled, there's the goals and objectives we need to accomplish to make the vision happen, there's all the accountabilities and roles that need to be maintained so that we've got a healthy enterprise, then there's all the projects we have to finish about all those things, and then there's all the action steps we need to take. I couldn't get it any simpler than that. So you have all of those multiple levels there. The reason I say that is because if people think they don't need any help, they're not playing a big enough game.
Wow.
Come on. I've had people tell me that if your business hasn't set a goal that would take at least 100 years to manifest, you may not be playing a big enough game. Now, there's nothing right or wrong about that. I wouldn't make that a judgment that people, maybe they're fine exactly where they are. So I'm not going to try to poke somebody and tell you you're not fine.
Yeah.
It's just I'm suggesting that if people really start to focus on their vision, God, you know, my vision and purpose really is that we create a world where there are no problems, there are only projects. I need all the help I can get.
Right.
We barely started. You know, so I got a big game. And so anybody that can help, that's why I'm very happy to talk to you, talk to people about what this methodology is. There may be somebody out there that'll hear it, that it'll improve their condition. So that's what I'm about. So if somebody is not interested in any help, they're either, you know, that's fine with me. It's called get to a no as fast as you can. You know?
So beautifully said. So it's the context of your life, really. If the context is small and you can manage it, then you don't need any help. But if your context is really huge, and then this whole thing of how do I build my competencies, how do I get productive, my efficiencies, my effectiveness, all of these kind of conversations begin to open up. And then very quickly, you know, you really begin to realize that you're at the mercy of the Peter principle, that you've now risen to your level of incompetency, and then you want to move forward, which is, you know, people really think that that's quote unquote a bad thing. But then I kind of think, you know, when I was in the seventh standard and I finished my curriculum, I wrote my exam, I was promoted to the eighth standard, I experienced myself as capable but not competent to write the eighth standard exam. I had to go through the whole curriculum to really, you know, gain competency. So I think, you know, this whole process of what, so there's a doingness that I'm hearing in you know, your work, what I've been observing, which is the getting things done, you know, follow the steps. But at the end of the day, it's the whole beingness that's getting freed up. There's presence, and in that presence, the ability to relate to human beings, to relate to whatever your situations are. So in this kind of a space of, you know, what's your simple, elegant model that becomes aspirational for people, you know, from your own experience? Because at the end of the day, as a world authority in your subject, there are people they aspire to something which is very simple. So how would you articulate or describe that?
Well, it really comes down to the essence of productivity, which is what are you trying to accomplish, and then how do you move forward to make that happen?
Right.
So where are you going? What's the next step? Outcome and action are the zeros and ones, really, of what do you need to do? Now, that can become quite complex and subtle in terms of what do you want?
Right.
What do you want to experience? What do you want to have? What do you want to be? How do you want this to show up, you know, at some point? And then how do I move forward toward that? Interestingly, over the years, I've found people resist those two things like the plague. If you look at most people's to-do lists, they're things like mom or bank.
Right.
You say, well, mom, yeah, you probably had one, so why is it on the list? Oh, her birthday's coming. Great. What are you going to do about mom's birthday? Oh, I don't know. Yeah. So they've identified something that's got their attention, but they're not appropriately engaged with mom and birthday yet.
Mm-hmm.
They have to decide they're going to give her a party. What are they going to do? And if so, what's the next step? Oh, I need to call my sister, see what she thinks about mom's. Great. Now you're appropriately engaged. So it really has to do with this outcome and action thing is really the zeros and ones, but we're not born doing that. You actually have to learn that process. It's a cognitive muscle you have to train. And interestingly, why it's so challenging for people, I think, I discovered recently, is that those two things use two different parts of your brain. The vision part uses the forebrain, you know, that part of you, the frontal cortex, where it sees the picture, it sees the image, it sees the desired outcome. But the limbic part is the one that actually executes, and it's
right.
Actually it gets you going. It gets you active. That's taking activity. The interesting thing is once you've trained yourself to think that way and to engage with your world that way, then you start to experience the beingness. What seems to be true, at least from my experience, is that on this planet and this material world, we're teleological, and the way to be is to do. So the people that I know that I would say are the most being kind of people are high doers.
Right.
They really are. And it's not about sweat or work harder or spend more time. It's about I'm appropriately engaged in what I'm doing. Because even when I meditate, you know, that's not going unconscious. It's a very conscious process. You know, I'm very focused on meditating. Or I'm very focused on taking a nap. See, there's a power nap, and then there's a nap to avoid your life.
Right.
The power nap just looks at everything and says, time for a nap. I'm out. Or time for a beer. You know, or time for to work on the strategic plan, or time to do this, that, or the other. Again, it comes back to when you have that sense of just being present, there's no distinction between being and doing.